This is Dan Dix here, reporting for Press for Truth. It's the summer of 2017, and by now, chances are every single person watching this video has one of these either in their pocket or in their hands right now. There's also a really good chance that you are completely unaware of the effects that these devices are having on your psyche and on you physically, and that's by design. So in today's video, we're going to lay out the truth about smartphones and wireless warfare. Now, as the title of this video suggests, we're going to be looking at a declassified military document that details the effects and the clinical manifestations of microwaves and radio frequency radioactivity on human beings. But before we do, let's take a look at what our devices say today about what is acceptable and not acceptable exposure. Now, we're going to be doing this on an iPhone 6 Plus, and you can follow along at home. So what you want to do is first go into your settings, and then we're going to go into general. From there, you're going to go into about, and then we're going to scroll all the way down to legal. Within legal, you'll find RF exposure, and here is where they have laid out what is apparently acceptable radio frequency exposure. You'll notice that it says here that during testing, iPhone radios are set to their highest transmission levels and placed in positions that stimulate use against the head with no separation. Now, you'll also note that it says at the top of this paragraph, specific absorption rate, or SAR, refers to the rate at which the body absorbs RF frequency. Now, in the following paragraph, following the fact that they just stated that testing is often done with these devices held against the head with no separation, it follows it by stating the following. To reduce exposure to RF energy, use a hands-free option such as the built-in speakerphone, the supplied headphones, or other similar accessories. Carry iPhones at least 5 millimeters away from your body to ensure exposure levels remain at or below the as-tested levels. And it also goes on to say here that cases with metal parts may change the RF performance of the device, including its compliance with RF exposure and guidelines in a manner that have not been tested or certified. So it seems that they are well aware of the effects that this can potentially have physically on human beings, because where do people hold these phones when they're talking? Against their head, or they're either directly right in their pocket, and when they're right here in their pocket, they're essentially right beside your genitals. If you're male, they're right beside your testicles. If you're female, they're cooking your ovaries. And in fact, the men who are responsible for the creation of these devices knew exactly what was going on, hence why men like Steve Jobs would not allow his children to use iPads or iPhones. Bill Gates is also notoriously known to keep his children at a safe distance away from using these devices. So clearly, they know something that you don't. And perhaps they were privy to this report that details precisely what these frequencies do to us psychologically and physically. This is the report released by the Naval Medical Research Institute. The bibliography of reported biological phenomenon or effects and clinical manifestations attributed to microwave and radio frequency radiations. This was conducted by the Naval Medical Research Institute and the National Naval Medical Center in October 4th of 1971. A second printing with revisions was released on April 20th, 1972. And it goes on to say here that more than 2,000 references on the biological responses to radio frequency and microwave radiation published up to June of 1971 are included in this bibliography. It goes on to say here, 3 supplementary listings bring the number of citations to more than 2,300. So, well over 2,000 studies, experiments, tests, reports were done on the effects of these radio frequencies and microwaves on human beings, and it was all compiled into this one report. And when we scroll down here to find out what sorts of things they were detailing were, the effects on humans psychologically and physically, this is incredibly telling. And I'm just going to scan through this quickly, and I'll include a link in the description so you can check it for yourself. But here we see a heating of the organs, heating up the whole body, your skin, your bone marrow, the genitalia, tubular degeneration of the testicles, heating of the brain and the sinuses. It goes on and on here. Alterations in the biocurrencies of the cerebral cortex, central nervous system effects. We're talking about headaches, insomnia, restlessness, you know, automatic nervous system effects here, ranging from fatigue, structural alterations in the synapses of the vague nerve. Psychological disorders include something they call neurasthenia, or just generally feeling bad, just a bad feeling in general. Depression, impotence, anxiety, lack of concentration, hypochondria, dizziness, hallucinations, sleeplessness, insomnia, increased irritability, decreased appetite, loss of memory, scalp sensations, increased fatigability, chest pain, tremor of the hands. It just goes on and on. We go into changes in blood and bone marrow, cholesterol and lipids changes. We see here enzyme and other biochemical changes, to your proteins, toxins, fungus, virus inactivations, alterations in the rate of cell divisions. We have metabolic disorders, gastrointestinal disorders. This just goes on, and it just gets worse. Genetic and chromosomal changes. Again, I'll leave links in the description so you can check it out for yourself. Miscellaneous effects, changes in optical activity, loss of hair, brittleness of hair, sensations and buzzing, vibrations, pulsations and tickling about the head and the ears. This is just unbelievable what they've discovered way back in the 1970s. Again, I'll include a link in the description so you can check this out for yourself. So what does all this mean, and where is all this heading? Well, the current number of cell phone users in the world today is 4.7 billion, and that number is growing just as quick, if not faster, than people are being born. Well, I'd like to point you to this excellent article that was posted yesterday by Zero Hedge, which is titled, "More Lonely, Fewer Friends, Less Sex, Have Smartphones Destroyed a Generation?" And in it, they point out that there has been a massive change to teenagers and millennials in general with the advent of smartphones. There is compelling evidence that the devices we place in young people's hands are having profound effects on their lives and making them seriously unhappy. You might expect that teens spend so much time in these new spaces because it makes them happy, but most data suggests that it does not. The results could not be clearer. Teens who spend more time than average on screen activities are more likely to be unhappy, and those who spend more time than average on non-screen activities are more likely to be happy. There's not a single exception. All screen activities are linked to less happiness. It goes on to point out that today teens are less likely to date. This leads to a decline in sexual activity. Driving, a symbol of adolescent freedom, has declined. It's completely lost its appeal for teens today. The number of 8th graders who work for pay has been cut in half. It goes on to point out these charts showing how the constant presence of the internet, particularly social media, is changing the behavior and attitudes of today's teens. They are no longer hanging out with their friends. They're not in any kind of a rush to learn how to drive. There's less dating and therefore less sex or less general interactions with humans in general. They're more likely to feel lonely. They're less likely to get enough sleep. The correlations between depression and smartphone use are strong enough to suggest that more parents should be telling their kids to put down their phones. If you were going to give advice for a happy adolescence based on this survey, it would be straightforward. Put down the phone, turn off the laptop, and do something, anything, that does not involve a screen. And we have barely scratched the surface on this topic, especially when you consider the tech world's ideas for the future of cell phones, how they want to implement holograms and what's now called augmented reality, where you would use the phone peering through it here in real life to enhance your experience right here in reality. And what's even scarier is that people born after 1995 don't even know what life is like without these devices. They've been completely surrounded by them their entire lives. And the unfortunate reality is it's become extremely difficult to rid yourself of RF exposure in today's world. My livelihood and income revolves around social media and devices such as these, just like millions and millions of other people out there. But just like it's a good idea to go on a diet, or to maybe go on a bit of a detox if you've been binging on unhealthy food and drink, it's equally important to have an electronic detox, even just for a few days, to remove yourself completely from all electronic devices. Think you can go 2 days without looking at your phone or a computer or a screen of any kind? Give it a try, and I think you'll be surprised at how good you feel. Not to mention, it may dawn on you just how addicted you've become to these smartphones, which are really, in the long run, just dumbing us down. So I'd encourage you to try the 2-day electronic detox challenge and let me know how it went. And of course, this channel is only made possible through your patronage at patreon.com/pressfortruth, where you can contribute a monthly pledge. Or if you prefer, you can contribute directly to PFT at pressfortruth.ca/donate. Thanks for watching, and stay tuned, my friends, because we've got a lot more video reports coming soon. This is Dan Dix reporting for Press for Truth.